I want to kick this thing off, and I want to read a couple passages for you. Let's go to the book of Ruth. Let's go to the book of Ruth. It's going to be fun. Oh, boy. The book of Ruth. We're going to be in chapter 3, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 9. The book of Ruth, chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. Got it. Say, I got it. All right, here we go. One day, Ruth's mother-in-law, Naomi, said to her, "My daughter, I must find a home for you where you will be well provided for." Now, Boaz, oh boy, we love a little Boaz. Yes, we do. Now, Boaz, with whose women you have worked, is a relative of ours. Tonight, he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash, put on perfume. Get dressed in your best clothes. Won't he do it? Then go down to the threshing floor. But don't let him know that you are there until he has finished eating and drinking. That ain't apple juice neither, so y'all know. We should be all on the same page. Wait till he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, somebody say lies down. Note the place where he is lying. Then go uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do. I will do whatever you say, Ruth answered. So she went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking and was in good spirits, he went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. Ruth approached quietly, uncovered his feet, and lay down. In the middle of the night, something startled the man. He turned, and there was a woman lying at his feet. "Who are you?" he asked. "I am your servant, Ruth," she said. "Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are a guardian redeemed of our family." All right, let's go to Genesis 29 real quick. I want to read one more passage. Genesis 29, we're going to start at verse 14. Starting at verse 14. Reads like this. Say, I got it. After Jacob had stayed with him for a whole month, talking about Laban, Laban said to him, "Just because you are a relative of mine, should you work for me for nothing? Tell me what your wages should be." Now, some of us would love this job. His boss said, "Tell me what you think you should get paid. What do you think you should make?" Anybody want that boss to have that conversation with him tomorrow? You see, you ain't excited enough. See, only 7 of y'all going to get a blessing when you walk in work tomorrow. No, just like, all right, here we go, here we go. He said, "Tell me what your wages should be." Verse 16. Now Laban had 2 daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah was weak in the eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Jacob was in love with Rachel and said, "I'll work for you 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel." My God. Laban said, "It's better that I give her to you than some other man. Stay here with me. So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel." Key point. But they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife." I love this part. All the men say, "Here we go. Give me my wife. My time is completed and I want to make love to her." Y'all don't want to read the whole Bible. I read the whole thing. I'm reading the whole thing today. Let us pray before this word comes forth. God, help us. Help us hear your word. Help us hear your heart. And God, my prayer most of all is that they not see or hear Vernon Gordon, but that they simply hear and see the face of you that lives in me. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today I'm excited to kick off this new series called 5 Heartbeats, 5 conversations, as I mentioned, specifically designed to address the health and wellness of our hearts. And it is my conviction that what our culture often affirms to us is that we have to live and love a life that is rooted often in feelings and in flesh. We often have a culture that affirms to us that the best way to love and the best way to live is how we feel. But I believe that's faulty foundation today. And so the Bible clearly affirms to us that the foundation, I believe, of everything that we kind of seek and desire is quite simple. He says the quality of the heart. I'll prove it to you. Proverbs 4:23. It reads like this. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Another translation says, guard your heart above all else, for out of it flows the issues of your life. We live in a culture that tells us we can fix our issues, but I come to let you know that we can't fix our issues without fixing our heart. It's going to be a quiet day. And I believe that in this particular sermon today, I want to be very clear that there are different type of preaching styles and there are different ways to approach a sermon. Today, I'm going to probably give you a little more scriptures than usual because I want to build a foundation for the argument that we'll be discussing all month. I want you to write three things down on your paper, if you would. Put them in your notes. I want to use an extended amount of scriptures and a little bit more time today to really lay a firm foundation for how we date and how we love and how we marry and how we sustain quality relationships. And I believe it all goes back to the quality of our heart. But I want you to write down three areas that this series will cover in totality, and today we'll kind of introduce. The first is the desires of your heart. The second is the disciplines of your heart. And the third is the depth of your heart. The desires of your heart, the disciplines of your heart, and the depth of your heart. And so as we begin to go through this series, I want to make sure I give you kind of the range of what we'll be discussing. Today, we're going to deal with a sermon title called Happy Heart. Somebody say Happy Heart. You know, we're going to talk about happy hearts, but in the weeks to come, we'll do a sermon series where we deal with the dangers in Delilah, because we all have one. But the problem isn't with Delilah. The problem is often with our desires. We're going to do a series where we really address wholeheartedly the issue of sex in our culture. And we're going to talk about this sermon series called, that sermon is called Body Language. Because sometimes your mind is telling you no, but your body is telling you yes. Y'all ain't going to say nothing in here today. Boy, I'm ready to preach all four of them right now. Let's just stay to the Super Bowl. Let's just stay. And then we're going to do a moment where we call it speaking from experience, a panel discussion, because here's the reality, guys. I'm not the foremost expert on commitment. I'm not the foremost expert. I'm still learning every day, and I think it would be selfish of me to know that there is wisdom that has been poured into my wife and I and not afford that same wisdom to you. But watch this. It would be immature of you to not want that information because of the messenger that it comes through. It would be immature if you say, well, what's Sunday Vernon not preaching? Because I just want to hear. And I said this on Tuesday night to a lot of people, that oftentimes we miss our miracle because we have already determined what messenger we'll take it through. And the next two series, if I want to be honest, will engage the voices and the wisdom of others to help us grow and develop. It's going to be a wonderful series. But today I want to talk about happy hearts. I want to talk about happy hearts. And I want to make a bold statement right from the beginning, that happy hearts don't exist. I want to say that happy hearts don't exist. I want to show you a couple images of great relationships. I think we all can agree Barack Obama and Michelle Obama. Anybody? Gosh almighty. Thought I was going to get a better clap than that. My wife cries everything. Anybody woman cry every time Michelle and Barack do something? Like, she's like, did you see the way he kissed her forehead? You don't never kiss my forehead like that. I'd be like, he got trainers, okay? They got people telling him. You know what I'm saying? I don't got nobody training me. I'm figuring this thing out on my own. You know, we love Barack. I mean, when we think about the Cosby family, anybody remember the Cosby family? Like, they were, that is just love, right? That just looked like love. I mean, we're talking about pre-incident. We're not talking about post. Okay, Dr. Cosby, amen. Family Matters. Anybody remember Family Matters? Wanted a good show. It was a good show. What about, let me see if you got this one. Let's move on to Kim and Kanye. Anybody know about, we don't love Kim and Kanye? We don't think, we ain't trying to get a Kanye Kim, man. Okay. This one just broke the internet. What about J&B? Got they new babies coming. All right, I think you already saw one, Gary Owens. Anybody know about Gary Owens? Yeah, he got him a sister. Said, I'm going to show y'all something. I'm going to give me a sister. Okay. This last couple, I'm telling you now, like, they are the standard. Oh, Kev, I didn't know they put that one up there. I didn't know. That one nice. Go ahead, Kev. Got a new woman. We ain't talking about the last relationship, but he got a new one. All right. But this last couple, I mean, I'm telling y'all, they are like the standard of good relationships. Like they are what we should all aspire to be. Go ahead, put that on the screen. This is like where you got to go right here. Back to 2007, baby. You understand what I'm saying? Junior year. Y'all don't know. Go ahead, keep rolling those. Keep rolling. Boy, look at the boy with the swoop. Freshman year, baby. That's freshman. Anybody remember spring ball at VCU when they used to have them? Come on, keep those babies rolling. I know we got, boy, that boy look good with that fitted on. Well, we're smooth, boy. My first surprise party. I remember that girl. I think we got one more. That's high school. Go back to high school. Look at that. That's when my earrings was bigger than my ears. Look at that. That's love right there. That's love. Did I have a do-rag on? But the ball was in the back, though, so it was cool. We got love. And here's the reality of it, y'all. You know, we get people ask us all the time, you know, they ask us about our relationship and we start to think about relationships and marriage. And here's, I think, one of the challenges of culture. Many of us are drawn to the picture of happiness, but not the process of happiness. Because, see, the thing about that pictures freeze time. And pictures aren't an accurate reflection of the amount of work ethic that it took to produce that happiness. They're not an accurate depiction of the long nights and conversations. They're not an accurate depiction of how many arguments you had to get in to get to a place where you understood each other. They're not an accurate reflection of how you had to work through conflict. They're not an accurate reflection of the fact that you didn't always get some stuff right. And sometimes we are drawn to the picture of happiness, but not the process of happiness. And so we pursue relationships and we pursue commitments, but I want to just make sure you understand this today, that happiness can start love, but only healthiness can sustain it. Only healthiness is going to sustain. And a lot of us are happy, but we're not healthy. You know, they cute. That's happy. That makes me happy. But are you healthy? Are you healthy? Do you feel like you can completely be yourself? Can you work through conflict together? Can you develop common goals and interests? Are you just happy, or are you also healthy? And I want to kind of dive into this as we approach the first segment of what we're going to build foundation for today, which is the desires of your heart. Somebody say desires. Desires will drive our decision making. Psalms 37 and 4 says it like this: take delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Now, many of us love that part, but then the verse after it says, commit your ways to the Lord. So we want the desire, but not the commitment. And so what happens is often our relationships are one area of our lives where we pick our own way to do it. And so then we're still getting desires of our heart, but we get upset when those desires didn't manifest. They manifested into happiness, but not healthiness. God, why does it turn out like this? Well, you got what your heart wanted. It just wasn't my way. We got to look at what is God calling us to, happiness or healthiness. The desires of our heart. I want to talk about this story of Boaz and Jacob. It's a very common story. We talk about relationships. I think it's very interesting. Can I just give y'all a little background? Say I can give you a little background. Is that all right? See, what's interesting about the Boaz story is Naomi's and Ruth's relationship. You got to understand the background. Naomi is Ruth's mother-in-law, and her son has died, and now Ruth is without a husband. And so Ruth is in this interesting situation, Marcus, because in this culture, if you were without a husband, you really didn't have a provider, and you really didn't have, just talking about culturally back then, I know some of y'all are independent women now, I-N-D-E-P-E-N, I know, but you know, talking about back then, because I know y'all going to have an attitude. But I don't need no man. Okay, good, fine. You don't need nobody. I understand. So don't come crying in the office when you can't find nobody. I'm just saying. I'm just playing. That never happens at TLC. Joking. God is good. The desires of your heart. Look at what happens, y'all. Ruth. I'm going to pick on the men, too. Don't worry. Ruth is without covering. She's without commitment, which means she's also without stability. She's without opportunity. She's without what she needs to really become a secure woman in this culture. This is Ruth's situation. And Naomi is her mother-in-law and doesn't want to see her in this position. And if you read the first two chapters, you'll realize that Ruth and Naomi have a very close relationship. They often speak of their love for each other. But when we walk into this passage, we encounter the three characters in a very different state. Ruth is yet to be able to find a spouse. She's yet to be able to find someone to take care of her. She's yet to be able to find someone to commit to her. And so Naomi comes up with a great idea. Go down to the threshing floor. And then I got to explain to y'all what the threshing floor is. The threshing floor in this day and age was where they would go, and in a harvest season, they would get grain. But everybody went at the same time, all the landowners. And they would wine press. So they would work all day to get their grain. They would work all day to get all they could out of this season. They would work all day. And then in the night, they would go to a specific place and lay down, and they would have fun. They would drink, and they would get the spirits, it said. They would get Moscato, and they would get some Sauvignon, you know, you ever be at the place that can't pronounce it? Sauvignon Blanque. Can I get a Blanque, please? They're there. They're doing that, right? And they get to the threshing floor. And so they would drink and they would party. And then in this culture, prostitution was legal. And so they would invite women to come and lay with them. I mean, just reading the Bible, right? Y'all saw the same scriptures as me. I'm just saying, if we're going to read the Bible, let's read all of it, right? So can I explain? And so Boaz is there. And Boaz has done all these things that I've just aforementioned. He's went and he's worked all day long. And then after working, he's went and he's collected his grain, and then he went out with his guys, and then she said, wait till he finds a place to lie down after he's eaten and after he's drunk. So he's done all of that, and he's in a compromised state, and then he lays down, and then he said, no, go uncover his feet. Now, oh, cool. Tap your neighbor and say, it's about to get good. In this culture, the uncovering of the feet had sexual connotation. And so when I uncovered your feet, I was basically saying, I'm available to you. Y'all see the sign? Boom. I'm available to you. So it was a statement that the prostitutes would do when they came down to initiate activity. Here's why this is interesting. It paints a very different picture, because we keep walking around talking about find your Boaz, but Boaz was not found with a great relationship. Boaz was found with manipulation. I'm trying to figure out why we keep chasing Boazes, and Boaz didn't want Ruth. Ruth pushed herself on Boaz. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing today. This is not a story of love. It's a story of manipulation. I'm just reading the Bible. I hope y'all read the same scriptures as me. I'm just trying to make them plain. This is not a story of love. It's a story of stability. Naomi understands the challenge that Ruth is in, it says, I got a plan to help you find stability, because if a man would have laid with you, he would have had to stay with you. Okay, let me help the men real quick, because we are in a culture now, though, where we want to lay with you and then leave you. But if you laid with them, you got to stay with them. And so I'm going to just preach to y'all for a second. It's getting real aggressive out there. I'm looking at some faces that don't look good. Just to make sure we understand both parties' place. So they understand the cultural implications. And I just want to bring us up to speed so we can understand the story through a modern lens. That it's a story of desperation. It's not a story of depth. It's not a story of commitment. And we keep telling people, wait on your Boaz, but Ruth didn't wait on nothing. Y'all read the same scriptures as me. That's why I put the scriptures up first. And here's the struggle. Her desire is for stability. Now, what I find interesting is, as much as we post about finding Boaz, we don't post about finding Jacob. Because Jacob, it said, loved the woman so much that he worked for 7 years and it only felt like a few days. I don't know about y'all. I just wish I could find somebody who worked for 7 years, but their love for me made it feel like it was only a few days. Okay, let me help two people. That's why a man who can't work for you can't really. Oh, boy. Let me come down here. Because work is a prerequisite for articulating value. He didn't just walk in and say, I want her. He said, I'll work for her. And some of us have allowed a DM to become the prerequisite for our relationship. And I just wish a few people would say, I'm sorry, boo-boo. My quality and my standard is too high. You're going to have to put in some work for me. You're going to have to put in some time, because faithfulness is not determined by what they say, but by what you see. He was faithful. He was faithful to something. And based on his faithfulness, they determined if he was credible to be committed. His faithfulness was determined not by what he said, but by what they saw. So this is why I tell people all the time. They say, well, he said he's going to be faithful. Well, has he been faithful to anything up until this point? Has he been faithful to a job, or does he leave that when it gets difficult? Has he been faithful to an idea, or does he stop that when it gets difficult? Because if you don't show me faithfulness nowhere else, why should I believe you're going to make it through the difficulty with me? I'm just trying to give y'all a rubric. That's all. Just a couple points. His faithfulness is exhibited. Now, let me help the fellas real quick. I ain't saying it got to be 7 years, bro. I ain't saying. It's cultural, okay? I'm just saying. It's cultural context. Make sure we all together on this thing. But there was some faithfulness and some work that went into him proving himself. Here it is. So here we are, the desires. The desires of your heart dictate the health of your decisions. And you got to start, you got to start asking yourself, am I making healthy decisions? Or am I making decisions that are led by my desires? Desires. Okay, here it is. I gotta move. Here it is. Not only do we see the desires of the heart on display, we see the disciplines of the heart we have to work on too. Somebody say disciplines. I want to read to you Jeremiah 29:17, changed my life, 29:17. Because a lot of us feel like the heart naturally or intuitively wants to do the right thing. But here's what Jeremiah 29:17 says. The heart is deceitful above all things. And beyond cure, who can understand it? Verse 10, though, but I, the Lord, search the heart. I, the Lord, search the heart. So we see here in this particular passage that it says the heart is deceitful. I mean, how many of us can be honest? We done some dumb stuff because your heart was attached to some stuff. Your heart will play tricks on you. And if you don't have disciplines and boundaries set up to control your heart will lead you into decisions that are contrary to the way of the Lord. Look at what he says again. Let's connect all the passages now, right? I will grant you the desires of your heart. Verse 5, commit your ways to the Lord. So God wants commitment to his ways. And so that means in order for me to manage the deceitfulness of my heart, the emotional roller coaster of my heart, the idea that my heart will immediately get attached to stuff. The fact, so when I got to manage that, I got to manage it with disciplines. So look at what Jeremiah says. He says, who can understand it? But I love what he says after that in verse 10. But that's what the Lord is looking at. The Lord is looking at our heart. He's looking at our heart to assess where we are and where we can go. Some of us, okay, can I help 15 people? Some of us have been praying to God to bless us. Some of y'all been praying for God to bless y'all with a Boaz. I pray that prayer changes. You've been praying for God to bless you with the man or the woman of your dreams. And you think because of what you present publicly that you are qualified, but God says, I'm looking at what is happening inwardly to determine your readiness, because the Lord is not looking at what you post. He's looking at your heart. He said, the Lord examines the heart. So based on the discipline of the heart, the Lord said, I know what you're ready for. I know what you got. I know what you need. The discipline of the heart. That's what we're going to be talking about over these next several weeks. Now, I want to make sure we explain this, because whenever we talk about the heart, love comes into the picture, right? Like, we have to understand love to understand the quality of the heart. And disciplining the heart often becomes difficult because of our one-dimensional aspect of love. So can I just take my time right here a little bit, teach on love? When you understand the Greek writings of the word love was so vast, it was so ambiguous that they had four different words in the biblical text to describe love. I want to go over these real quick for you. This is a note-taking day. Somebody say foundation. Foundation. We got to get the foundation. We got to get the foundation right. So there are four different Greek words used in the Bible for love. The first one is storge, which means affection. It is a love that is motivated by familiarity. It is a love that is motivated by familiarity. It's that friend that started dating somebody, and now the longer they date them, they start sounding like them. You be like, you ain't even from New York, son. Like, why you saying son? Start talking like them. Their mannerisms change a little bit. Because their love is growing through familiarity. We spend some time together. We're connected. It is a love through familiarity. That's what affection is. Affection is the most forgiving type of love. It's the love that we extend to family members, no matter how many times they mess up. Why? Because we're familiar with them. And so the greater my familiarity, the more forgiving I am. So a love through familiarity, affection. Here's another word used in the Bible for love in the Greek text. Philia, which means friendship. It is a love motivated by mutual interest or compatibility. Meaning, you can't just look cute. Meaning, you just can't be 6'2". The standard has to go beyond that into a mutual interest or some sense of compatibility. And some of us are happy with the way we look with the person, but we're not happy with the time we spend with them. Boy, I thought they was going to shout this Sunday or something. No, I didn't. Eros. It is a romance or sexuality love. Motivated, okay, here's the part, by attraction. This is the love we see on greatest display in culture. This is the love that's on our Instagram accounts. This is the love on our Facebook profile. It is an attractive love. I just thought about this on the spot. I dare everybody this week to post, if you're in any type of relationship, just post a picture of what your relationship really looks like. See, y'all ain't going to laugh on that, because you're like, dang, that ain't going to look as good. You know, after 17 tries to kiss at the right time with the camera like this. But show the one when you're sitting on separate sides of the couch. Show the love that walks in the house and doesn't say hello. Show that love, because that's a part, but we don't show that. We show eros. And so we will show eros while philia is not even existing in our relationship right now. We're attracted to each other, but we have no friendship. It's a romantic love motivated by attraction. And can I just pause right here and say something real quick? Can you just tap your neighbor and say, help Vernon out on this, please? Stop telling people that they showed you affection because they touched you. Because watch this. Because affection is not the product of touch, it's the product of time. you can't really be affectionate with me until we've been time with each other. There is a different type of love for my touch. But stop telling people they were affectionate. Affection is the product of time invested. Y'all ain't gonna clap. I know, I only got two. It's cool. I know our number's gonna drop next week. It's all good. Affection is the product of time. It is a love through familiarity. If you ain't familiar with me, your touch didn't mean that you're affectionate. Your touch means you want something before it's time. All right, let's move on. We have the three. Let's go to the four. Agape love. One we hear in church often, it is a charity or a selflessness. Love motivated by seeing the good and joy of others. It is a selfless love. Here's the thing about agape. We often apply this particular love to the love that Jesus showed us. It is a love that loves us in spite of us. It is a love that gave his life so that we could be redeemed. It is a love that said, even when you were in your sin and your destruction and your habits, even when you were distanced from me, I still loved you. That's what I love about God. It's one of the only religions in the world where we communicate a God that says, hey, I love you in spite of you. It's a God that says, I didn't just sit up here and you down there. I came to you because of my love for you. It is that type of love. And it is a goal, but let's be honest, some of us don't really do this one well, because we often love out of our need and not the need of others. Can we just build a foundation today? We often love out of our own insecurities. We often love out of our own desires. So we come into relationships saying, here's what I need. It takes time to build selflessness in love, that we can find excitement in the joy and in the good of others. There's four different words used. So when we start to talk about love in our culture, I'm hoping that you have a bigger view, a bigger scope, that love is in layers, and that just because one person can love you in one layer of love doesn't mean they really love you wholly. It takes layers of love. You cannot love my body before you love my conversation. Whoa. Gosh almighty. You wanna call me a friend, but you don't want to spend time with me building affection and familiarity. It takes time, it takes being familiar. It takes friendship and compatibility and mutual interest. And I want to be clear today. I'm not saying that everybody on your list that you're talking to right now, because you know you got a list. I'm not saying that everybody on your list, you know, the people you talk to. I'm not saying that if you, or I'm not saying if you're married. Either way, I'm not saying that if you right now say, hey, man, what are we doing? Me and Ashley, one of the things we did recently in the past year of 2016 is we said, man, we're going to find something that we both like to do. Be practical for a second. We said, hey, me and Ashley are very different. Like, my idea of a rest day is let's invite everybody over for a cookout. You know, good times with friends and stuff. Ashley's idea of a rest day is in her pajamas watching Law & Order SVU. I'm not a fan. Y'all clapping. I don't like it. I don't like it. No, I don't like it. It irritates me. I got to go do something. And then look, and here's the awkward moment, fellas. Watch this. This is the awkward moment you get stuck in. So my presence is not enough? Like, you don't just want to spend time with me? We've been here for 4 hours. What else are you going to talk about? What else do you want to talk about? You know, watch every episode. Jesus. So We had to learn. I'm not saying you're going to have it all figured out. I'm not saying if you're talking to somebody right now, we're not even friends. We don't even got no mutual interest. We can't be together. I ain't saying that. I'm saying sometimes it takes work, and we are addicted to the picture of happiness. But if you see any quality relationship, it took work ethic to make it healthy. We got to talk about some stuff. We got to sacrifice. We got to compromise. We got to figure this thing out. And so here's where we are. We're like, okay, well, what do you like to do? What do I like to do? So we're finding mutual interest together. Got to do it. You got to work. This type of love takes work. That's David, next Sunday, can I get this mic'd right here? I want this section mic'd so we can have it on the playback. Because the people on the playback don't be knowing what we're doing in here, for real, for real. All right. I love you. Let's talk about the depth of the heart really quick before we leave. Foundation. Somebody say foundation. Just building the foundation for the rest of the month. The depth of your heart matters. 1 Peter 4:8. Please get that up. Get that up on the screen for me, Amanda. 1 Peter 4:8. I know I sent you a new version. Yep, that's perfect. Most important of all, continue to show what kind of love? Say it again. Say it again. For each other, for love covers a multitude of sins. Can I help three people today? This is only going to help three people. You cannot build deep love with shallow people. And one of the greatest challenges is we keep trying to talk to shallow people and get them to think deep. If they have no depth in their heart, they won't be able to see beyond Eros. All they will see is your body. All they will see is your hair. All they will see is your outfit. All they will see is your shoes. All they will see is your car. All they will see is your bank account. But when you find somebody who says, I want to love all of you, I want to be your friend, I want to know your familiarity, I want to be affectionate, I want to spend time with you, I want to be quality and not just quantity, I want to work with you to make this love work, you will find out that you have a deep love and not a shallow love. Boaz and Ruth is a shallow love. It is a love based on an economic gain. Jacob and Rachel is a love based on time, commitment, and work ethic. This is the type of love that we should pursue. It's a different type of love. Ruth got a stable man. Rachel got a faithful man. Fellas, I don't got one for y'all today. But when you come back week 3 for the dangers of Delilah, it's going to be good. And here's where we are. We're trying to build something with a shallow perspective. This is why this series is so important, because it's going to take everything in you to purge yourself of all that culture has taught you love should be and look like. All of the pictures that you thought marriage was going to be like. You thought that it was going to be one way, and then you get into it and you say, oh my. Maybe my picture of love, I was drawn to the picture. But I didn't know the process. I didn't know the work ethic. I didn't know what it took to move from happy to healthy. I want to go back to my original statement when y'all thought I was a heretic. Happy hearts are not what God is trying to create. God is trying to create healthy hearts. Happiness is an outcome, not the foundation that you build on. I'm going to say it again, because we've been taught in culture to pursue what makes us feel good. They make me feel good, but is it healthy? That takes depth. That takes moving beyond what culture tells us to shallow limitations. And I want to challenge you today to stop trying to make your heart healthy, happy, and start making it healthy. Start making your heart healthy. Start taking the time to say, Lord, search my heart. And I don't want it to just be happy. I want it to be healthy. So if you need to add some new disciplines, bring them my way. If you need to expose me to the reality that I have some shallow places inside, that my heart is attracted to some things that have no depth, work on my heart. That, Lord, I just want to be honest about the fact today that there's some desires in my heart. There's some pictures of what I wanted that may not be what I need. God, work on my heart. God, work on my heart. Because what is the Lord looking for? Jeremiah said it. He said, the Lord is looking at the heart. If you could stand on your feet all across the room today.